Second Timothy chapter 2. Our God and Father, we thank you today for the privilege we have of fellowshipping together with one another around your word. We thank you for our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray as we study today that our instruction and edification might be to his honor and glory. We thank you in Christ's name. Amen. Second Timothy 2, verse number 15, a very basic verse of scripture you're very familiar with if you're here at Shorewood very much. Study. And that's what our meetings are about. We meet here to study. We're not here to be entertained. We're not here to be tantalized and that kind of thing. This is a classroom for the intake of sound doctrine out of God's Word. And a local church is really more than that. It's really sort of a life science laboratory where you don't just learn God's Word, but you learn to live it in relationship to others. But you have to study. Study to show thyself approved unto God. That's the goal. Have His approval. A workman, that's what's produced by God's Word working in you, that needs not to be ashamed, and the key to doing it is rightly dividing the Word of truth. That issue of right division of the Word of God, that's just the basic overview. We've been studying that now for a few weeks just to refresh our minds about these things, the importance of it. And the issue of it's called dispensational Bible study, that's a big Bible word. A lot of times people don't like big words. If it's got more than two syllables in it, a lot of times people think it's, you know, over the head to get at church. But when you come in here and you come into a local church, you're not supposed to leave your brain in the parking lot. Now, a lot of churches you go to, that's what you do. You just unscrew your brain, put it in the glove compartment, lock it. You're going to need it when you go home, but you don't need it in church because it's all entertainment. It's all religious rote going over and over, doing the same kind of things over and over. When you come to God's Word, you need to study it so that you can gain an understanding of it. And the issue of right division is to get that basic overview, get a panoramic view of what God's Word is so that you can understand it. You look back at verse number 7. Paul said, consider what I say. Now, you're going to find that in your Bible. You got a King James Bible, you find out what God says. Paul says, consider what I say, and the Lord give the understanding in all things. In other words, you want to have the understanding in what's going on, and you're going to get that by listening and reading what the Bible says, and particularly what the Apostle Paul says. Look with me, if you will. Hold on to that. Look at John chapter 17. This is not something new in your Bible. John chapter, I said 17, but I meant 7. First mistake I've made yet. When I make a mistake, she's supposed to fix it before it comes out, right? There you go. I know she can do that. I get all this help. My wife sits back there and gives me signs and stuff, you know, and I've got a help up here on my left hand, and I like that on my left hand. See, they're getting it, people. Okay. John 7, verse 16. Jesus answered them, and he's talking to the Jews that he's dealing with. They said in verse 14, now about the midst of the feast, Jesus went up to the temple and taught. And the Jews marveled, saying, how knoweth this man letters, having never learned? He doesn't have our sheepskin, didn't go to our college and learn to do what we said to do. How is it he can teach with such authority? Jesus answered them and said, my doctrine is not mine, but him that sent me. In other words, I'm teaching the Word of God. If any man will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself. If you want to do the will of God, Jesus said, you've got to know some doctrine. You've got to know what the Father teaches. You don't just decide, well, this must be what God wants done, and pull it out of your head. You get it out of God's Word, and to understand the will of God, to know the will of God, to know what God's doing and your part in it, you have to know the doctrine. So it's important to get the truth out of God's Word. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, correction. People love the reproof, they love the correction. They like when you preach against sin, they like when you preach against, you know, Aunt Tilly's issues. But it's the doctrine that gives you the capacity to understand those things and to have clarity. Everybody says we need to go by the Bible. I have heard preachers, but not in, you know, circles we'd be around, more Bible-believing people, that would say we don't need to go by the Bible. But the key isn't just I'm going to go by the Bible, because everybody claims to go by the Bible. The key is how do you know for sure that what you're going by when you go by the Bible is what God wants you to know. And that's what the issue of rightly dividing the Word of truth is about. Come with me to Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2. If you want to know how to rightly divide, you've got to do it right. Not just make divisions, but do it God's way. then you need to look into the Bible and let God's Word tell you how to do it. Paul said, consider what I say. So let's consider for a minute what Paul says about rightly dividing his Word. And the Lord give the understanding. If you want understanding about how to rightly divide God's Word so you can understand what God's doing in the Word of God for yourself, this is the key. Ephesians chapter 2, Paul lays out his understanding. That's what that this timeline up here is about. Ephesians 2, verse 11. Wherefore remember that ye being in time past, Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision, but that which is called the circumcision in the, made, in the flesh made by hands. Notice there's two people. There's some people called the uncircumcision, and then some people call the circumcision. Now, you know, if you know your Bible, what circumcision is about. That's the sign and the seal that God gave to Abraham for the covenant that he made with Abraham. In fact, in Acts 7, that covenant that he made with Abraham is called the covenant of circumcision. So there's two groups of people in the Bible. There's Israel, who have this the circumcision sign as being a people from God, and then there's everybody else. Verse 12, that at that time ye Gentiles were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope without God in the world. That doesn't sound like a good way to be, does it? You're outside. You're on the wrong side. You're not a part of what God's doing. The division is circumcision. He made a, what he calls in verse 14 and 15, a middle wall of partition. He partitioned off, he walled off his people from everybody else. So when you find in your Bible, when God is dealing with people on the basis of this distinction between the circumcision, the nation Israel, and the uncircumcision, the Gentiles, when you find in your Bible where that's the way God deals with people, you know where you are. You're in time past. How do you know? That's what the verse says time past is. The basic characteristic of time past in your Bible is that is God dealing with man on the basis of the distinction between Israel and the Gentiles. And when you see that distinction, you know where you are in your dealings with your Bible. Verse 13, but now you who were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. Something has changed. God has changed the program and the operating system from time past, distinction between Israel and the Gentiles, to but now when there's nobody that's far off. In fact, over here he says there's neither Jew or Gentile, bond or free, but there's no difference between them. So there's a radical change. Listen, a six-year-old who flunked kindergarten can get this. Sometimes preachers that have been to seminary know Greek and Hebrew like they know English. They've got all the education. They don't get it. Because the way you get this is just believing the passages. When they contradict what you've always been taught, you just let them contradict it, and you stick with what the book says and not what you've always been taught. Amen. All of us are that way. Everybody in this room has been there. You know that. The key is what the book say. I'm going to have God's approval. This program in here is entirely different than that one back there. How do I know? I can read. One program, there's that distinction between the Jew and Gentile. Here, that distinction is done away with. Now, in the future, verse number 7, for in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us. Think about how brilliant this is. Time past, but now ages to come. What's that? Time past, present, future. That's time. This is a timeline. God lays out his word on a timeline. And then you put the events and the things on the timeline where they belong. So as you read this information, tell you what, get Romans chapter 15 with me just a second. Romans 15, verse number 8. Now I say that Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision for the truth of God to confirm the promises made unto the fathers. Now Jesus Christ is God in human flesh. He's our Savior that died at Calvary to pay for your sins. But in his earthly ministry, he was also a minister. And he was a minister, what does the verse say? Of the circumcision for the truth of God, to confirm the promises made unto the fathers. When Jesus Christ in his earthly ministry, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, who did he come to minister to? He came to minister to the circumcision. In Matthew chapter 10, when he sent his apostles out in the first great commission, he told them, he said, do not go to the Gentiles. it would be hard for anybody following the book of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John to preach in Chicago. John chapter 4, verse number 22, he told the Samaritan woman, he said, salvation is of the Jews. Now, people just, you take two aspirins and a glass of milk and go to bed, hope it goes away tomorrow. But the verse is still in your Bible. And what they're telling you is that the program in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is not the program over here in Romans 5. This program over here is the program in time past. So you're still in time past when you're in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, because that middle wall of partition is still there, and that's the way God's dealing with people. It's not me. It's what Jesus is doing. He dies, is resurrected, goes to heaven. The Holy Spirit comes on Peter and the apostles. And what do they say when you start the book of Acts? Go with me to Acts chapter 2. Hold on to Romans 11. If you didn't, you know your way back. Acts chapter 2. The Holy Spirit comes, fills the apostles. They speak as the Spirit gives them utterance. So in Acts 2, verse number 14, Peter's going to explain what's going on. Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, ye men of Judea, and all ye that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken unto my words. Well, who's dwelling at Jerusalem at the time? Go back to verse number 5. And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men, out of every nation under heaven. Why were they there? They were there for Pentecost. Three times a year, Deuteronomy 16, 16, every Jew, every male Israeli, no matter where he lived and what nation, was required by God to come to Jerusalem for the Passover, for Pentecost, and for tabernacles. By the way, in Deuteronomy 14, that's one of the tithes that they had to give every year. It's fascinating. They had to give a tithe to support the government, the temple, called the temple tax. Then they had another tithe that they stored up themselves to take those three holidays. I've always thought I could get you to tithe if I let you do that. You could have one tithe, and going on an Alaskan cruise. Oh, you couldn't go on an Alaskan cruise. You had to go to Jerusalem for the Passover, Pentecost. But that's what they did, so that they could have God's blessings, celebrate God's blessing on the nation. So Peter's addressing these Jews from every nation that's come to Jerusalem to worship at Pentecost. Verse 15. For these are not drunken, as you suppose, seeing it is but the third hour of the day. But this is that which is spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out of my Spirit upon all flesh. So why did the Spirit come on the day of Pentecost? It came in fulfillment of Joel chapter 2. See that? Not hard to understand. How do you know that? That's what the Spirit of God said through Peter. I think the Spirit of God knew what he was doing. People say, well, he didn't really know. Yeah, he did. God, the Holy Spirit, knew what he was fulfilling the prophecy in Joel 2, and the Holy Spirit came on Israel. Verse 22, ye men of Israel, hear these words. Who does Peter think he's supposed to be talking to? No, who did Peter talk to? Not that he thought. He's talking to you men of Judea, you men of Israel. Verse 36, therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly. Listen, there were Gentiles there. There were Roman soldiers there. If I stood here and I said, everybody here from Texas, I got a word for you. Well, you guys, anybody else here from Texas? Would you worry about what I said to them? You might be interested. I'm interested in what, we're all nosy. But if I told them something specific for them, you'd know I'm talking to them and not you. When Peter said, you men of Israel, you men of Judea, all the house of it, he's singling out, you know what he's doing? He's singling out this crowd of people and saying, I'm talking to you, the Spirit of God's talking to you. He's not talking to these people down here. That's time past. You know why you go back in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, try to take things that are in those books and try to put them on yourself and they don't work? You know why you go to the early Acts period and try to take all the Pentecostal signs and wonders and blessings and try to make them work in your life and they don't work? Alex played that thing a couple of weeks ago in the Sunday school class of Sid Roth, trying to teach people how to tongue talk. Look at Acts 2. Nobody had teaching about how to tongue talk. God, the Holy Ghost, gave them the gift and the blessing instantaneously, empowered directly. And you got preachers all the time. I watched Andrew Womack on the TV not long ago, and he's saying, what you need to do, and you just, and you read that, you say, what in the world is that? Well, that's not any different than you go down to a formalist church and the teacher recited prayers and you memorize them and you give them out. It's formalism, it's fanaticism, but it's flesh, it's not what God's doing. You got to understand that. How do I know that? I can read my Bible and I know who he's talking to. He didn't talk to you. That's Israel's program. And when you see that, you say, well, that's time past. Go back with me to Romans 11. Because, you know, if you're like me, okay, that's theirs. Where's mine? Romans 11, verse 13, or verse 11. Romans 11, 11. I say then, have they stumbled? Talk about Israel. Have they stumbled that they should fall? God forbid. Israel stumbles at Calvary. He laid in Zion that stumbling stone, that rock of offense. And they stumbled over the Messiah. And they said, crucify him, away with him. We'll have no king but Caesar. And Jesus from the cross said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And he literally postponed the execution of the fall of Israel at that point, just as Israel had rejected God the Father who sent John the Baptist. They rejected God the Son by crucifying. He sends the Holy Spirit, and what do they do to him? Instead of receiving the testimony of the Holy Spirit, they speak against him. And Peter says in Acts 7, you stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart. You guys up here, your heart is these people down here. Have they fall? Did they fall? Verse 11. Have they stumbled? They should fall? God forbid. But through their fall. Well, if they don't fall here, they did fall here. Through their fall, salvation has come to the Gentiles to provoke them to jealousy. Everything back here in prophecy. And think about that. Peter says in Acts 3, this is that which is spoken by the mouth of all the holy prophets since the world began. Has to do with this kingdom that's going to be established over here. But now, in this thing that's called a secret, the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began, but now revealed. Here's something new on the scene. And through the fall, not through Israel's rise into their kingdom, but through the fall of Israel, down here on an equal level, no longer the distinct, the change came with the ministry of Paul. Verse 13, for I speak to you Gentiles, inasmuch as I'm the apostle of the Gentiles, I magnify my office. God literally changed the program by changing the apostle through whom he's going to speak. And just as Jesus Christ and the 12 spoke for the Father back here, the apostle Paul now speaks for Jesus Christ, who from heaven gives him the information. He wrote 13 books in your Bible. They start with his name. It's meant to be easy to find your doctrine. I mean, we're a bunch of dumb thump Gentiles. We need it easy. So God made it real plain. He put our guy's name right at the first of all of our books, written direct. All the Bible's for you. You know that. I mean, you know how we are here. We defend every verse in a King James Bible as being the Word of God in our language. Don't leave any of them out. Don't add any to it. Just let it be and study it. But we know that they're not all written about us. And then all written to us. If he could tell Noah to build a boat to the saving of his house, I ain't building a boat to save my house. I've seen my grandkids try to kayak. That isn't God's program for us. And if you can understand that, you can understand this. So where our program is today is in the but now. Paul said, Ephesians chapter 3, maybe you should look at it. Now, listen, I'm doing a 10-minute or 15-minute now review, okay? You didn't think I could do it that fast, did you? I'm going to move on from this, but we weren't here the last week, and I wanted to bring you back up to snuff here. Ephesians chapter 3, for this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles, if you have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given me to you, word. See that issue of the dispensation? A dispensation, to dispense means to give it out. The noun form of the verb is a dispensation, what God gave me to give you, the doctrine. How that by revelation he, that's Christ, made known unto me the mystery, the secret. As I wrote afore in few words, whereby when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. What does that verse say you have to do to understand it? Didn't say you had to pray about it. that you had to read about it. When you read words on the page in your Bible and you let them form your thinking, that's how you understand stuff. Follow that? People say, I'm going to pray about it. You don't need to pray about it. Look at the verses. It's either right or it's wrong. And if it's right, what do? You believe it. You don't have to pray about it. It's what the verse says. Now, I'm not discounting prayer. I'm saying that's not what, you can pray about it all day. You know when what you do when you start talking about, start praying about it? You start praying about what it's going to cost you to believe it. Hello. Been there that too. Verse number 5, which in other ages was not made known to the sons of men. Now wait a minute. If in other ages it was not made known to the sons of men, did Joel know about it in Joel chapter 2? Joel chapter 2 is part of prophecy. Joel knew about, Peter said, what's happened on the day of Pentecost. What happened on the day of Pentecost wasn't a secret. Paul says, what I've gotten here, Joel didn't know about. There's no way what went on at Pentecost is part of what we're a part of today. Entirely different programs, which in other ages was not made known to the sons of men, as it is now revealed. Aren't you glad you now know it? Bless God. Verse 6, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and protectors of his promise in Christ by the gospel. Whereof I was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of his power unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. Jesus told the Pharisees, he says, search the scripture, for they are they that testify of me. Paul said, what I'm preaching about Jesus Christ, you can search the scripture that they had and never find it. Something new. To make all men see what is the revelation, the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world has been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. That's what a mystery is in the Bible. It's not something spooky. It's not something superstitious. It's just information that was hidden that is now revealed. If it wasn't now revealed, you wouldn't know it was there. So it's been revealed. That's why he calls this the mystery. Why he calls it the secret program. Now, that issue of the difference between Israel's program and us, that's the great division in the Bible. It's a division between prophecy, that which is spoken by the mouth of all the holy prophets since the world began, Peter says in Acts 3, and that which is kept secret since the world began, but now is revealed. And if you can get that difference, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the earthly ministry of Christ to Israel, Book of Acts, you start out with Israel's program, the offer given to them, and they're rejecting of it. Paul's epistles, you have what God's doing today. Hebrews to Revelation, you have what's going to happen in the future when he brings it all to fruition. The very index on a King James Bible is laid out with a panoramic view of your Bible. Now, to me, that's one of the most fascinating and helpful things you could ever learn. So now I just need to go back. I know where the verses fit. I got a verse that I don't understand. I got a verse I've been trying to obey, and it doesn't fit. If I know where to put it, it doesn't become frustrating to me. You know, one of the biggest frustrations in the Christian life, for sincere people that want to believe the Bible, follow the Bible, go by the Bible, is to have verses in the Bible that don't work. Yeah. Amen. You know, you say, must be something wrong with me. That's what the preachers tell you. Listen, if you're in Christ today, there ain't nothing wrong with you. You're complete in him. You're blessed with all spiritual blessings in heaven. God isn't holding anything back from you today. He's already given you his son, and with him gave you all things. You don't have to go anywhere, do anything, move a muscle to gain anything. It's all yours. You're blessed with all spiritual. How much more than all can it be? You're complete. How much more complete can you be? You're looking for a fulfilled, purposeful, meaning, validated life. You have it in Christ. You never find it anywhere else. We seek validation. We seek purpose. We seek fulfillment. We seek whatever in thousands of places that are so infinitesimally smaller than our Savior. Just relax. Don't worry about religion. Get off the treadmill. Relax. This is who God made me. So what God thinks. That's how complete you are in Christ. And I say, whoa, what a status. We're sons of God, heirs of God, joint heirs with Jesus Christ. That's where we start. It's not where you attain to. And you go to, I look at that and say, whoa, man. And then you find a verse over here and you say, but that verse doesn't work. And the preacher says, well, see, you got sin in your life. You lying rascal. People say, well, you need to confess your sins to get God. You know what you do when you go confess your sin to God? Oh, Lord, I did thus and so today, and please forgive me. He said, I already have. You say, Lord, I'm going to do better next time, and I just want you to bless me. I already have. That's the truth. That's what you ought to live out of, is that confident reality of your current, present, real identity in your Savior. It's called grace. All that God's free to do for you through His Son. Get off that treadmill of you trying to do it. You trying to stop something. Talked to a guy just last week. And he said, but Richard, I have this besetting sin. He's full of anger and he just can't keep from striking out. And he lost his job because of it. And he said, I just can't get. I said, you lying rascal. What does Romans 6:7 said? He that is dead is free from sin. If you're free from sin, then why do you sin? Not because you're chained to it and can't do other, just because you chose to do it, dude. Well, no, you did. He said, no, I didn't. I said, you calling God a liar? Call me one all day long, you'll be right. Call God a liar. What's the verse say? What is the reality of your spiritual life? Where does the life that you have in Christ come from? As long as you're trying to do it, listen, you can't overcome sin. The cross does that. That's where victory is. But how do you know that? You know it by studying your Bible. You know it by seeing who you are in Jesus Christ. And by the way, you don't get it by living under Israel's law program, a performance-based program, in order to get the blessing. You live it under grace where you got it all up front. And now you just need to be excited about living the reality of who you are. And the guy looked at me and says, are you serious? I said, now for me to say this is dangerous, but as a heart attack. And I said, why don't you get off your pride horse and just admit that you can't do it, that God did it for you in His Son. And why don't you say with Paul, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And why don't you live by, you know, we want the default position in our life to be faith. It isn't. The default position in your life is flesh. You know why that is? Grace will only accept faith, but grace requires faith to operate in your life. It requires your choice. The Word of God works effectually in you that believe. It requires you to believe God's Word. And you see something in your life, and you say, I need to overcome that. I need to deny ungodliness and worldly lust, get it out of my life, and put on sober righteousness. You know how you do that? By faith. Now, what that means is, doesn't mean just, I'm just going to grunt and push hard and I believe it. It means you're going to go find the verse in your Bible, start in Romans 12, and find the passage that addresses the issue you're having, and then believe what the passage says to do about it. That's the obedience of faith. And you know what you do when you do that? You'll find the transforming power of the grace of God working in your heart to change you from the inside out. And I can tell you, that's true of every situation you face. Some of us get really deep in the weeds of life. Some of us never got off in the weeds. You ever play golf with somebody that never hit anywhere but the fairway? What a frustrating experience that is. Did you know a Tiger Woods or a Jack Nicklaus never hit the fairway all the time? Did you know they only hit the fairway about 60% of the time? Boy, when I read that, that was encouraging. Because I don't do 60%. I'm down to the 30%. But to know that the best in the world, I said, wow, they know how to play out of the weeds too. And when you get in the weeds in your spiritual life, understand the answer is not by you cutting down the weeds. The answer is by who God's made you in Christ living in you. He equipped you for that. Okay? Now that's my rant. If you don't understand where you are in here and you're trying to live in the identity of somebody you're not, you wind up in confusion. And you wind up with the Bible being a burden to you instead of the blessing God intended it to be. Because when you don't live in the identity that you have as a member of the church, the body of Christ, and the body of Christ is not back here in this program, that's something else. Listen, you're not big enough to make God do something He isn't doing. He isn't doing that program. I don't care who you are. I don't care how much religious power you have. I don't care what kind of momentum you have. You're not going to make God do something he isn't doing. You need to get in line with what he's doing. He's forming the church, the body of Christ. He's not kingdom building. He's not reclaiming real estate. He's not reclaiming social structures. He's saving sinners out of the weeds of life, putting them in his son, and he's going to use us in the ages to come for something very special. Now, having said all of that, that bird's eye view, if you get that in your mind, then when you study your Bible, you can know where things fit and why they fit there, and you can believe what they say instead of be confused. I'm listening to the radio, our radio station, and they have a program on in the afternoon. Two nice young guys, they're in their late 30s, early 40s, pastors around the area here, and they're constantly talking about being a Christ follower. And I'm thinking, a Christ follower? Gandhi was a Christ follower. Did you know that? He thought Christ was a wonderful guy to follow. I'm thinking, this is a lot. You know the difference between being a Christ follower and being saved? It's like the difference between being saved and lost. You know what the problem with a great majority of evangelical churches is? They're full of lost people. They're full of Christ followers. Not people that have come as bankrupt, lost, helpless sinners to the foot of the cross and said, you save me or I perish. But they come with their works. They come with a good life. They come with a good thinking. They're good social attitudes. They're good. The guy's talking to an Episcopalian lady and a Lutheran lady. And we're all Christ followers. But listen, if that Episcopalian lady believes what her church believes, they're basically Protestant Catholics. You remember where the Episcopals came from, the Church of England, the Anglicans. In fact, actually, she is an Anglican. And Anglicans, when King Henry threw the Catholics out of England, he made it the Anglican Church of England. He didn't change the doctrine. He just changed they didn't have to listen to the Pope, had to listen to him. Lutherans over here, same kind of deal. And you say, well, if they believe what their church teaches, they believe in baptismal regeneration of babies. That isn't how you get in the family of God. That's not how you get in the... Do you understand what I'm saying? When you say, Christ follower, we can get Gandhi into that. You can get Muhammad into that. Did you ever read about Muhammad? He recommends Jesus as a prophet. That's not how you get saved. You die and go to hell believing that. But there's prominent people in the evangelical world. I've talked to these guys. They know the gospel. They know what it means to get saved. But when you're talking out there, you can't talk like that and get listeners, followers. So you say, wow. So where do you go to get that? Wrong place. Now go back with me to Ephesians chapter 2. I want to move on from there just a little bit this morning. Get Ephesians 2 in one hand and Romans chapter 9. Ephesians 2 and Romans 9. Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 11. Wherefore remember that ye being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands, that at that time ye Gentiles were without Christ, being strangers from the commonwealth of Israel, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise. Notice that God had a special nation, and he had made that nation some promises. We talked about this last time. And when he made them promises, he took those promises and said, I'm going to make a contract with you, and he made covenants of promise. So Israel has these covenants of promises that you aren't a part of, they belong to them. All of the covenants in your Bible belong in that program. Look with me at Romans chapter 9. You hear preachers do this all the time. We're the blood-bought covenant people of God. Well, let's question the assumption. Romans chapter 9, verse number 4. Who are Israelites? To whom pertaineth the adoption and the glory and the covenants? And the giving of the law and the service of God and the promises? whose are the fathers, out of whom, as concerning the flesh, Christ came. That's why it says in Ephesians 2, you were without Christ. Why? He came to this special nation who had some special promises and covenants of promise. But who does that verse say covenants pertain to? Israel. Who does it say the promises pertain to? Israel. So when you read about covenants in the Bible, you're not reading about this group of people over here who had none. This little piggy had roast beef. This little, you know, remember that? This little piggy had none. And he went, wee, 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 wee. Here we are over here just squealing because we're left out. There's God's program with them. When you read people talk about covenants in the Bible, don't include yourself. You don't get included in these blessings because God made a promise and a covenant to you. You get included by His grace. You didn't have any claim on Him. So the covenants of promise that God made, He made them with that special nation, and He made those special contractual agreements. And it had to do with a literal, physical, visible, earthly program that comes through the nation Israel. Go back with me, if you will, to Genesis chapter 12. I'm slowly working my way back to where I wanted to get here. Genesis 12 with Abraham. Now the Lord had said unto Abraham, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee. Underline the land. And I will make of thee a great nation. Underline the nation. And I will bless thee. Three things. I'm going to give you a land. I'm going to give you a great nation to dwell in the land, and I'm going to bless you. I'm going to give you my salvation and my blessings. God promised to Abraham, then He made it into a covenant, chapter 15. Then in chapter 17, He makes the covenant. He gives the covenant a sign of circumcision. We've been over why He did that. So you have these covenants of promise. The promise begins with Adam and Eve, the promise of the seed of the woman. The seed of the woman becomes the seed of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and the nation Israel. And Israel has three things that He promises Abraham, three basic things. The land that I'm giving you, it's yours forever. Who owns the earth? The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. He assigned over that land of Israel to them. A nation, people to dwell in the land. Doesn't do any good to hold land if you don't have somebody to occupy it. Doesn't good to have people occupy, to be a nation of land for them. In the Bible, Genesis 10, a nation is made up of borders, language, and culture. He gave us, I'm going to make you a great nation. And then I'm going to bless you. Because Israel had the same problem you have. We're all sons of Adam. We all come in the world lost. And God said, I'm going to redeem Israel, and then I'm going to make them my people in the earth, and then I'm going to bless all the earth with them. I'm going to give them. You say, it says it in verse 2, I'll bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. I'll bless them that bless thee, curse him that curseth thee, and in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Any Gentile that wanted blessings from the God of the Bible in time past had to go to Israel to get it. The doorway, the bearer of the blessings, was that seed line, the nation Israel back there. If you come over to Exodus chapter 19, when he explains to Israel what their hope is going to be, why he's made them a great nation. Exodus 19, verse 5, talking about the Exodus. Now, therefore, if you will obey my voice, Exodus 19, verse 5. I'll start in verse 3. Moses went up unto God, and the Lord called unto him out of the mountain, saying, thus shalt thou say to the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel, you have seen what I did unto the Egyptians, and how I bare you on eagle's wings, and brought you unto myself. I have separated you away from all the other nations, Egypt is a type of the world, and brought you unto myself, separated you out here as a separate, special nation, a holy nation, a set-apart nation. Now, therefore, if you'll obey my voice indeed, keep my covenant, then you shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and an holy nation. I'm going to make you a kingdom. You're going to have a land, a people, and you're going to be a whole kingdom of priests, people that take my word and represent it to the Gentiles. Isaiah 61, when the Gentiles look at Israel in that kingdom, Isaiah 61, 6 says they'll be called the priest of God. There'll be a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a kingdom. That's why God created Israel, to be His nation in the earth. His kingdom nation in the earth. You go to Daniel chapter 2, come to Matthew 24, 25. If you go to Daniel chapter 2, and don't go there, but go to Matthew 25. And Daniel sees that kingdom coming. And he says Christ's going to come back and establish His kingdom on the earth and wipe away all the Gentile imposters and usurpers. Matthew 25, when Jesus comes back, this Christ talking, 25 verse 31, when the Son of Man shall come in His glory and all the holy angels with Him, right here, when He comes in His kingdom, all the holy angels with Him, then shall He sit upon the throne of His glory. That's a literal, physical, visible, you know where the throne of His glory is? That's Jerusalem. Chapter 5, verse 35, it says, don't swear by Jerusalem. It's the city of the great king. And He returns to set up His kingdom. He gathers those nations before Him. Verse 34, then the king shall say unto them on His right hand, come, ye blessed of my Father. What did God tell Abraham? Them that bless thee, I'll bless. Here's the people going to receive. Here are the Gentiles that will receive the Abrahamic blessing. Come, ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom, watch, prepared for you, from the foundation of the world. This has been that kingdom is what God has planned for man from Genesis chapter 1 when He put man on the earth. It's called prophecy. That was just spoken by the mouth of all the holy prophets since the world began. That's different than that which kept secret. That program is His purpose for the nation Israel. Now, I want you to think about something. When God separated Israel away to do that, He left the Gentiles down here. Now, why did He do that? And more important to me is, what is the condition of the Gentiles when God took Israel out of them? Come with me to Acts chapter 14 and Acts 17. Because if you've ever wondered how to think about what's going on in the world out there today, and if you've ever tried that, you're pretty well, you know, you give up pretty quick. In the last 2 weeks, I've read two books. One written from an evangelical believer's point of view about what's currently called social justice. Back when I was young, it was called the social gospel. And there's a philosophy of the world called critical theory. And now when it morphs into social justice, it becomes critical race theory. And the believer guy, he's talking about you don't want critical race theory, you don't want social justice, you want biblical justice. And if you want to see what biblical justice is, in Paul's words, Colossians chapter 4, verse 1, is just and equal. And if you apply that to the culture, you'll have biblical justice. And he makes the arguments for it. The other side is a fellow on the other side of the political spectrum who is promoting the ideas. And he's talking, and it's all this, it actually goes back before Marx, but it comes through Marxism when they reject, Marxism didn't work, you understand that. And nobody's a Marxist today because it doesn't work, but they morph it into the Hegelian kind of, and you read all this stuff and you say, wow, that's the reasoning, it's all this stuff, you know. And you're the golf ball in the weeds trying to figure out what's going on. And I said, there's one guy over here, another guy over there, and there ain't nobody in the middle. And I said, you know where God's word is? It's back over here. So you say, how did they get that? How did this guy get to thinking that? How did that guy get to thinking that? And how come there's this chaos? If you want to know listen, I've said this to you for years. If truth isn't at the table, error will answer the problems. The problems are going to get answered. Because people can't live in chaos and anarchy. And if truth isn't there, the only thing to answer it is error. So how did you get where you are? Well, look how the Gentile world thinks, and you'll see it. Acts chapter 14, Paul's talking to some pagans. They've called him Mercury and Jupiter. They tried to make sacrifices to him. Verse 15, Paul says, sirs, why do you these things? Why are you trying to make sacrifices to us? We also are men of like passion with you and preach unto you that you should turn from these vanities. Now remember that term. These empty, worthless ideas unto the living God. You read that word vanity. You remember Ecclesiastes, vanity, vanity, all is vanity, saith the preacher. Everything, you know, Solomon says, you come, you live, you die, you come, you live, you die, you come. And it's just, it turns out to be nothing. Turn from these vanities. Unto the living God, which made heaven and earth, the sea, and all things that are therein, who watch in times past, suffered all nations to do what? Walk in the... There was a time in history back here when the nation said, we don't want God. So God said, I will let you go in your own way. Dream up your own thinking. And I'll take my nation out, and I'll make me a nation. I'll show you what it would be like if you had me as your God. So in time past, there was a point where God allowed the nations to walk in their own ways, develop their own thinking processes. Chapter 17, verse 30. Again, Paul's at Mars Hill. He's talking to the Athenians. He's talking to the intelligentsia, the elitist of his day. He says in verse 30, and the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent. Now, things are different than they were back there. And he says, where you guys back were back there is you were ignorant. I love when he says that because it's such a funny thing. You've got the intelligentsia of the educated world. I told you when I was in college back in the 60s, the head of the English department, he thought the Greeks were the greatest thing. Here are the Greeks. The American education system was based on Greek thinking. And he said, greatest thing, greatest minds, greatest scholars. Plato, Aristotle, Euripides, Hermogenes, all these guys. They were the greatest bunch of plagiarists that have ever lived. You know, our president, first time he ever ran for president, had to quit because he plagiarized some British guy's speech. He's done that all his career. But he's not the worst one. These Greek philosophers were. You know where they got all the? They got it all out of the wisdom literature of the Old Testament. They plagiarized. It was on the table in front of them for hundreds of years before they ever said anything. Every philosophy of every Greek philosopher that you can list, you can find his philosophy in the book of Ecclesiastes. But who studies Ecclesiastes? Oh, I thought that was Israel's program. Yeah, it is, but boy, you can learn a whole lot by studying that. Okay? I'm sorry, that's another rant. My wife calls those rabbit trails, and they are. But my point is that God left the Gentiles to their own thinking. And when Paul calls them, he says, "This times of this ignorance." Acts 17, 22. Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hills and said, "Ye men of Athens, I perceive in all things you're too superstitious." I love that. He said, "You elitists, you philosophers, you Epicureans, you Stoics." You know, the Stoics followed Zeno, and the Epicureans followed Epicurus. Great Greek philosophers still being taught today, still being read today. Paul said, you're just a bunch of superstitious numbskulls. Read the next verse. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God, whom ye therefore ignorantly worship him, declare. Paul said, you're a bunch of superstitious ignoramuses, just put it like that. And you go, oh, you shouldn't talk about them like that. Well, Paul did. I'm just quoting Paul. I'm a nice guy. Paul sometime wasn't. When you compare human viewpoint, when you compare the thinking of this crowd down here to the way God thinks, that's what they are. Now come with me to Romans 1 and see how they got that way. How is it that they would reject what God's doing so thoroughly that he would separate a new nation away from them? Romans chapter 1, verse 18. Here's how the heathen got to be heathen. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. That's the cusp of it. They held the truth in unrighteousness. They didn't hold it correctly. How would you hold it correctly? You'd believe it. By the way, the wrath of God is revealed from heaven. Have you seen God's wrath anywhere lately? Have you seen fire fall? I had a friend one time down in Alabama. He went to guy in our church, a young boy wanted to call on his daughter. So he came to the door, and her dad came to the door and looked at him and said, "Who are you?" And the boy said, "I thought it was Moses going to strike lightning on me." Well, some of you guys with young daughters, you could appreciate that. Notice how God's wrath works in this chapter. He didn't work up a sweat. He doesn't, boom, lightning bolt to anybody. Look, notice what he does. "Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so they are without excuse." Nobody's born an atheist. Every book written, I've read every one of them that's been out in the last 20 years, every prominent atheist from Christopher Hitchens on, they all started out believing in God. Then religion got in the way and they turned their back on it. Religion makes more atheists than atheists do, because you're born with an innate understanding. Because that when they, verse 21, because when they, they're without excuse, because when they knew God, underline it, they knew him. You don't need to try to prove people that God exists. It's moral corruption that tells their mind he doesn't exist. Here's the thinking. They glorified him not as God. They weren't willing to let him be God, and they became indifferent to his Godhead. Neither were thankful. When you can't bow your head and say thank you for the food and the raiment that he gave you, Acts 14. Makes the rain just and fall the just and unjust. If you can't thank the Creator, that ingratitude, but became vain in their imaginations. Your imaginations, you think up things, you dream it up, and your thinking is worthless. It's vain, it's empty, it's purposeless. It never solves the problem. Their foolish heart was darkened. There's the ignorance. Because they didn't want the light of God's word, they just walk around groping in darkness, professing themselves to be wise. They don't recognize their own failures. They became fools. And when they became, they took God, the revelation of God, and they rejected it. And they didn't want it. So then they began to develop their own empty, vain, useless ideas to get rid of God. And they developed their own wise plan, smart plan, to get rid of God and to put themselves in his place. That's how the world solves its problems. Not God, our thinking. And then verse 23 says, "And they changed the uncorruptible God, the image of the glory of the uncorruptible God, into an image made like..." They went and got religious and started worshiping nature. Well, whose nature? Verse 25, "who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator." Get rid of God and we'll be our own God. Now, historically, that happened in Genesis 9, 10, and 11. And Paul's reaching back to the historical event to explain why God set the Gentiles aside and called out the nation Israel. But notice verse 24. "Wherefore, because they did all those things," verse 21, "God gave them up." There's the wrath of God. He didn't have to whack them. He just let them have their own way, because the wages of sin is death and the way of the transgressor is hard. And sin is its own payday. Choose sin, choose suffering. They did. And he said, "If that's what you want, have at it." Verse number, what is it, 26. "This cause God gave them up." You don't want me? Go in your own way. Verse 28, it says, "God gave them over." That's even worse than being given up. If I give up on you, I just say, okay. If I give you over to it, I say, okay, here, you're committed to it. And what God literally did, and you read it in Deuteronomy, is when he gave these Gentiles leave to go their own way, do their own thing, he literally gave them up to the gods of this world. The god of this world is the adversary. And all those different gods, instead of having Jehovah as their God, they have all these false gods, the satanic influence. He gave them up, verse 28, to a reprobate mind, worthless, useless thinking. They didn't like to retain, They didn't want him. The way the heathen got to be heathen is we didn't want what God said. We're going to do it on our own. And from then till now, until right over here when Christ comes back, that's going to be the way they think. That's the way the world thinks. And when you lay aside the revelation of God and you work and do like the world did, you'll be like them. Now get two passages, Galatians chapter 1 and Romans chapter 11. And here's why that's important for us. Galatians 1 and Romans 11. We read the verse in Romans. I won't read it again. But Paul said, I speak to you Gentiles inasmuch as I am the apostle of the Gentiles. Chapter 1, verse 5, he says about the risen Lord. He said, by whom we've received grace and apostleship to all nations. Paul got his apostleship from the risen Lord. 12 apostles made on the earth for his earthly program. One apostle made from heaven for the heavenly body. Chapter 1 of Galatians. If I ask you who's your apostle, don't say T.D. Jakes. Okay? If I ask you who's your apostle, don't name some priest. If I ask you who's your apostle, the Bible answer is Paul. How do you know? Romans 11, 13. Now notice Romans 11, verse 1. I'm sorry, Galatians chapter 1, verse 11. But I certify your brethren that the gospel which is preached with me is not after man. Neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. For you have heard of my conversation in the time past in the Jewish religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it, and profited in the Jewish religion above many mine equal in mine own nation, being exceedingly zealous of the traditions of my father. But when it pleased God who separated me from my mother's womb, God took Saul and separated him from that program into something different. Separated him from the nation Israel. And called me by his grace to reveal his son in me. That I might preach him among the what? The heathen. Paul's ministry was for the purpose of preaching to these people down here. The heathen. You need to understand why the heathen are heathen, because that's where our ministry is today. It's to the world. He set Israel aside down here, concluded them all in unbelief, that he might have mercy on all. That's why Paul's our apostle. And you got to remember why that's essential. You want to have salvation from the penalty of sin? You want to have eternal life? If you go back over here into this program over here, you're going to have problems. You know what Peter told them on the day of Pentecost? They said, what should we do with Christ? He said, repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. They couldn't get the Holy Spirit, and they couldn't get their sins forgiven, except they would repent, change their mind about the Messiah, trust him, and get water baptized. Verse 40 of that chapter says, save yourself. You can't do that today. They had a responsibility to do that because of that program. Chapter 3 of Acts, Peter says, repent and be converted that your sins may be blotted out when the times of refreshing come from the presence of the Lord. Now, if that's how you're going to get your sins blotted out, how you're going to get saved today, when are you going to get your sins blotted out over here? How are you going to know? You've got to endure it over there to get it. When you come to the Apostle Paul in Acts 13, Acts 16, he says something entirely different. He says, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, thou shalt be saved and your house. You trust Jesus Christ exclusively. You can be justified for all those things that you couldn't be justified by the law of Moses. Justification is the issue now. Not just forgiveness, but being justified before God through the blood of Jesus Christ. And if you believe it, and everybody in your house that believes it can get it. Now, you can spend all your time trying to figure out how to make those things put together. They don't mesh together. They butt heads. They're different. Paul says in Romans 5:11 that we joy in God by whom we have now. We don't have to wait to get the atonement. We get it right now. Now you put all those things on a piece of paper and you try to make them all one category and you say, this is confusing. But if you put them on the timeline where they go, all of a sudden it's not so confusing. You can say that's one program, this is another. And you can go, I had a V8 moment. I got this. Think about your walk as a believer. Deuteronomy, he says, you keep my, you're righteous, this will be, you keep my commandments. Deuteronomy 6, 24 and 25, for example. Perform. And when you perform, you want to perform as a believer, keep my law. Take the statutes and obey them. But you come to Paul, he says, for sin shall not have dominion over you. Isn't that what you want? You want to be free? For you're not under the law, but under grace. If your Christian life is going to function successfully, it won't function over here under the instructions of the law. Paul says we know that the law is not given for a righteous man. It's not the ethical standard for us today. Grace is. Because we teach people grace, so go live in sin. You're doing that already. You're pretty good at it too, weren't you? Aren't you? Yeah. But the grace of God teaches us that denying ungodliness, what did Christ do with the cross? He put away sin. He set you free. He made you free. And live soberly, righteously. If God's grace teaches you, you live in the freedom. Think about come back with me to Matthew just for a second. Get Colossians 3. I'm going to quit in just a second, sooner or later. The hamburgers are still cooking. I can't smell them yet, so I know they're still cooking. You guys in the back smell the hamburgers, raise your hand and I'll. Matthew chapter 7. All across Chicagoland today, there are people praying the Our Father prayer. It's the official prayer of the Roman Catholic Church and much of Protestantism. It ends with these verses, Matthew 6, verse 14. And if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Is that simple? If you forgive others their sins, your Father will forgive you. If you don't, He won't. So what does that mean? You better forgive. Because if you don't, your Heavenly Father isn't going to forgive you. And do you think it would be a little difficult getting into His heaven if you didn't have your sins forgiven? Now, let me show you one. Look over at chapter 18. Because every time I think about that passage, this one comes to my mind. Matthew 18, verse 21. Then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how oft shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Isn't that going to be the question? I've got to forgive him. How many times do I have to forgive him? Till seven times? Jesus said unto him, I say not unto thee until seven times, but until 70 times seven. Pete, you've got to forgive him 490 times. Now, I bet Pete thought, I would have thought, does that mean the 491th time I can nail him? I got to forgive him 490 times for my... But what about that next one? That next one I can go whack! You see that? You say, what is that? Well, there's some doctrine involved in that program back there. But now look at the contrast. Colossians chapter 3, verse 13. Forbear one another. And forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against them, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. How many sins did Christ forgive you of? We'll look back at chapter 2, verse 13. And you being dead in your sins and uncircumcision of your hearts, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you 491 trespasses. All. So when I forgive someone else as Christ forgave me, how many sins do I forgive? Not 491. All of them. Guys, you better be glad of that because your wife wouldn't make it till about May every year. If you're living under Matthew, then you'd be... All of them. I'm just trying to get you to see the difference and why the difference is important. There's nothing going to be any more intimate in your life than when you commune with your Father, your Heavenly Father, God and Father, in prayer when you talk to Him. What do you think God's going to say back to you? Matthew says, whatever you ask, believe and you'll receive. Ask, and it'll be given to you. Seek, and you'll find. Knock, and it'll be opened. Sermon on the Mount. How does that work out? It doesn't. And you say, well, with the preacher, I don't say the preacher, I'm talking about you. I say the preacher comes on and says, oh, there's sin in your life, or God just said maybe. He said, verse don't say anything about sin. Verse don't say anything about God said maybe. He said it will. Well, God's time schedule is there. You know what you're doing? You're just trying to make theological excuses to try to get God to do something he isn't doing. You go to Paul's epistles, and Paul's first thing he says about prayer in Romans 8, he says, we know not what to pray for as we ought. Now, you know that. But the Spirit makes intercession, helps our infirmities by making intercession. How does he do that? Somebody says, well, he just retranslates the prayers. See, that's more of that superstition. Because the next verse says the Spirit makes intercession according to the will of God. You find that in the Word of God. You know how the Spirit of God prays for you? He wrote a book to tell you how he thinks about you. And when you learn the doctrine, you learn how to study his word. You get the understanding of the doctrine out of his word. You get his doctrine. Then the word of God works effectually in you that believe it. That's why it's important. That's why we don't want to think out of our old vain imaginations. We don't want to think out of Israel's old program. We want to think out of the grace of God to us in Christ. You've never trusted him personally. It's not what you do or don't do. Down south, people always say, well, I can't live it, preacher. I said, thank God you can't. You never could. Christian life's impossible for you to live. God doesn't say you need to go live the Christian life. He knows you can't, so he gives you the life of Christ in place of your death. You can't get it by religion. You can't get it by something passed down to you from mom and dad. You get it when you personally, in the recess, in the quietness and stillness of your heart, your inner man, in that personal privacy where it's just you and him, you tell him, I'll trust your son. I trust your son. Not I will, but I do. That's my life. I trust him because he died for my sins. He rose again to give me his life. And I'll trust him to the Savior who died and rose for me. When you do that, just that personal privacy, God saves you. That instant, in a nanosecond, and gives you his life. Takes the burden of sin and failure away, gives you new life in Christ. And then the Word of God becomes something different to you. It becomes the life for your inner man. Then you can learn it and then live it, have it live in you. But that's what God's doing today, is forming that body. But if you've never trusted his son that way, you need to do that today. Right where you are. Not to go anywhere, move a muscle, pray a prayer, walk an aisle, shake a preacher's hand, do anything. All you need to do, all you can do, is look to him and trust him. And those of us that are saved, we need to realize, as you've received Christ Jesus, so walk you in him. The same principle is walking in the life that he gives us. Understanding out of his word, growing up, and being able to live as adults in the family of God. Okay?